Kept you waiting, huh?
You found Striker of Enyo, and we are celebrating the 15th anniversary of one of the biggest names when it came to content producers on the internet in the early days of YouTube. We are celebrating the work of Noah Antweiler, also known as the Spoony One. That's right, on this day, back on January 24th, 2007, Spoony released his first video on YouTube. It's been a long road for the Spoony One over the years. He was on top for a good 8 years for many people, but in the background, he has had health issues for over a decade and slowly became inconsistent with his work, to put it nicely. I've been a fan since the beginning, and I have decided to make this video in remembrance of his work. So sit back and relax. Let's keep the comment section positive and at least relatively constructive in nature when referring to Mr. Antweiler himself. And let's look back at the top 25 videos of Noah Antweiler, the Spoony One. I rated each video in a number of categories like originality, scripting, humor, anger level, and the amount of effort. But in the end, I also looked at the overall entertainment value. Don't worry, I use these ratings as more of a guide. Don't get too hung up on the order I put the videos on this list in either. This was just for fun. Please just look at this as a list of videos to start watching if you've never seen his content before. I hope it's a nice balance between his popular videos, his well-written work, along with the ones that are impressive on a technical level. Now, if you want to find and watch some of these videos on your own, I have bad news. There is no central place to view all of Noah Antweiler's work. Most of his older work is spread across the internet. You will need to visit multiple fan-made YouTube channels to find a lot of it, not to mention a couple of internet archive pages to find a good number of them as well. I don't have time to cover this now, but I made a separate video addressing this issue. It's called How to Find Noah Antweiler Videos Today, the Spoony One. You should see it pop up now as an annotation, but it'll be available later as well. I also made another video called The Top 5 Counter Monkey Episodes from Spoony. This video was just running a bit too long, so I had to break it off into its own separate video, so I hope you enjoy that. So look for both of these at the very end of this video, during the end card. You can also look on my channel for recent videos to find both of them. You can check the channel description below, or even search for them by name, so enjoy those. But yeah, I couldn't fit it all into one big video. Since I have been a longtime follower of Spoony, for many entries I'll be using my own fan-made video thumbnails that I did back in 2008 to 2013 or so. For the sake of brevity, from here on out I will be referring to Mr. Antweiler as Noah, or simply just Spoony. I mean no disrespect to him as a content creator, but it's just easier to refer to him in this way, so please excuse me for being a little less formal throughout the video. Check the description for time codes if you want to jump to a certain entry, or check the video playback bar itself. Yep, that's a thing now, and it works pretty good. So let's stroll down memory lane as we look at some of the best work that Noah Antweiler has put out. These are the top 25 videos of Noah Antweiler, also known as the Spoony One. Oh, and as a side note, we have two quick rules because, well, of course we do. I am Striker of Enyo. So what qualifies as a Spoony video? Well, number one, any video that is created by or has an appearance by Noah Antweiler. Rather self-explanatory. And number two, any multi-part content is condensed into one video. So for argument's sake, any video separated into multiple, quote, parts have been combined. And yes, that includes any multi-part reviews or Let's Plays. Number 25, Clones of Bruce Lee. Yeah, I made a weak thumbnail back then, but I made these for playing the video on my Xbox 360 at the time, and I was gonna be the only one that was ever gonna see them. They get better, so cut me a break. Shortly after Spoony moved out of his parents' house, the Final Fantasy VIII review finale and the Clones of Bruce Lee reviews had been the most complicated and the most difficult videos that Spoony had shot and edited up to that point. In the Clones of Bruce Lee review, Spoony sets up the overall premise.
They figure if they can get some of Bruce's blood, they can create clones of him and have the clones form a team of super spies that fight international crime.
That's fucking brilliant! Now that's science, guys. You don't just clone Bruce Lee once, you clone him a shitload of times, and then you send them all out to go kill people!
But the real clincher to this review is when Spoony has essentially three versions of himself on screen at the same time. Himself, Spoony Bum, and Dr. Insano. There are some good comedic moments with all three versions of Spoony on screen. I never felt it was overdone, and they don't even show up until 12 minutes into the review itself. On the forums, some fans were very vocal about not liking all the special effects and clone gimmicks. They'd rather have Spoonie just sit in a chair and present the review, and to some degree, Spoonie understands this viewpoint. And he admits he prefers the more straightforward style as well in the audio commentary of this video. I enjoyed the extra effort Spoonie put into this one, and it has one outrageous scene.
Because, you know, he knows something. So wait, Bruce, look out!
One of Dr. Nye's women.
Oh! Did you see that? Bruce just karate chopped the bitch in the throat. Bam! Oh! Oh, that's what you get!
It's the best moment by far, and it's even referenced in the animated intro. This review isn't as laugh-out-loud funny compared to the others on the list, and it's not the best written, but after all these years, I still remember it more fondly than several others.
Today we conquer Thailand, and tomorrow the entire world!
Number 24. The Spoonie Experiment Rift Theater presents Game Crazy Training Video. Spoonie was a big fan of Mystery Science Theater 3000. You know, those guys that would show up in silhouette at the bottom of the screen and poke fun of old movies.
Let's see. Oh, good flight, Cal.
Thank you.
So long.
Dickweed.
Jag off.
Other people need to use this ladder, you know.
Cal, what's wrong?
I have no control.
I keep eating and eating.
Wow, even the birdhouse is a duplex. Nice.
Whoa! Whoa! Dude, Zippo those jeans first.
The best part of waking up is letting my good hang out.
He had several videos that took inspiration from the show, where you would see him watching content and making comedic comments during the playback. This was known as riffing, and Spoonie did several videos based on riffing, but possibly the most popular out of all these were the training videos, namely the one for Game Crazy, a game store franchise that tried to operate similar to GameStop. The key to this video was the over-the-top style of urban delivery by the whitest businesswoman they could find, Zelda Scott.
I'm down here in the His House, you know, the Heezy, with the GC Posse, to get the 411 on Game Crazy.
Or the Game Crizzle, or the local GC.
It was nothing short of pure gold.
And if you sell them the right ride, you got a better chance of selling some 20-inch chrome rims later. Know what I'm saying?
There was even one outburst from her that took Spoonie by surprise while he was recording.
And they can't hate on our used games.
Because I will straight up bust a cap in your dome.
Come with a 90-day guarantee, and they cost less. Booyah! Now, for the real hardcore players, the ones that are crazy tight with the GC...
The whole video is an extremely tone-deaf look at humor in general, but Zelda Scott makes this one worth a look. Number 23. Lords of Magic. Spoonie loves to read. Just look at the shelf of books behind him in any one of his videos. He would rent out tons of the Choose Your Own Adventure books at his local library when he was younger. Before long, he then realized what a lot of us have over the years. The library actually has movies you can rent for free. No, they won't always be any good. In fact, they're usually bad. Since Spoonie had a love for fantasy novels at the time, he checked out this movie one fateful day, Lords of Magic.
This is some of the goofiest chipmunk shit I've ever seen in my life, and that should terrify you. I picked up two movies that day at the library. One was this, and the other was Captain America. And this one... is far, far worse.
It was an absolutely horrendous fantasy-based movie shot on video with almost no budget. Spoonie really has some fun on this one. The review was the starting place for a few running gags that you may have come across from other videos.
What magic be in a tavern? There'd be wenches in a tavern.
Okay, but if there's any girls there, I wanna do them!
The budget is so constrained that by a certain point, they basically just give up on trying to do a medieval setting whatsoever.
So after warping through the magical, mystical, tie-dye-colored world of unicorns, they reappear in- Okay, seriously, fuck you. No, that's- I can't- I quit. Not another one of these-
And they just teleport our heroes into the modern day. There's basically no effort in the story. It makes huge leaps in logic. It just happens to be a goofy, made-for-video event that turned into a Spoonie review that had enough good moments to make the list. With classic lines like-
Ulrich! 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 Go to the hall! Go to the hall!
Number 22, Minority Report. Everybody runs.
Wait, the game!
I sense the future. It's gonna suck nuts.
This original Xbox game was based on the movie, and aside from the usual trappings of movie-licensed games back then, you know, bad camera, shallow combat, unresponsive controls, the main aspect that Spoonie touches on in this review is the fact that you can grab any enemy and throw them to their presumed death.
Scream! What the hell is happening here? You're not John Anderson, you're Dirty Harry! You're a bad cop on the loose! Oh, fuck!
In any other game, this mechanic would be fine, but this is the world of Minority Report, which kind of flies in the face of the main plot device where three kids can supposedly see any attempted murder, you know, hours in advance.
That guy's fucking dead! Oh, God! He might not be dead!
If this was the case, as Spoonie mentions...
Ow! Would you stop it? They can't possibly be dead because A, the precogs would have predicted it, and B, it totally defeats the purpose of a story about proving you're innocent of a murder by publicly murdering several people by throwing them off an impossibly high skyscraper like he's just about to do. No! No, what are you doing? No! Oh my God, you killed him! Oh God, he was a cop!
This culminates into a hilarious montage of using that scene from Demolition Man while we watch the main characters throw people from high up. And then Spoonie gets showered in red balls as he continues to seemingly kill multiple cops and guards. If you haven't seen it, it's definitely worth it to see Spoonie make fun of this aspect alone.
And then throwing her broken ass down an 80-foot tube like she's the fucking emperor!
Looks like you're the one who got the shaft.
Oh, my eye!
Number 21. Let's play SWAT 4. Mission number 6. Red Dead Library. If you watch enough videos featuring Noah Antweiler, then you will run across a particular reference.
You're in my way, sir.
Oh, fuck off!
It's one of the longest-running gags across his videos, going back to about April 2009. And you even see it referenced in his animated opening. It all started in Spoonie's Let's Play of SWAT 4, which ended up becoming one of the big moments he was known for. During the series, he would insert a lot of movie and music references, go on tirades against his AI teammates, and really kept his energy up. Aside from the opening briefing, he was talking throughout the whole video. The first several missions are entertaining, but rather low-key. He completes each of them in one attempt. But once you get to Mission 6, the Red Dead Library, that's where Spoonie's anger overflows into one of the most entertaining exchanges with an NPC you will ever see. It starts with ordering your squad to stack up on a door. The game is programmed in a way that the AI-controlled teammates need to stand in a certain arrangement before they can breach a door. And if the player happens to be standing in one of those predetermined spots, well, that's when things kick off. At first, Spoonie was fine with being told to move, but by Mission 6, a new level of hatred had happened.
Searching the doorway.
You're in my spot, sir.
Well, maybe that's because I'm looking in the fucking room!
You're in my way, sir.
Listen, you sawed-off little twerp, you wanna do this? He's acting like I do it just to be an asshole. I mean, this isn't the fourth fucking grade. I didn't cut in front of you like I was in the fucking lunch line.
You're in my way, sir. You're standing in my spot, sir.
Just stand back there and shut the fuck up until I tell you to throw a fucking grenade in the room.
You're standing in my spot, sir.
Watch, it's gonna be the last fucking guy who says it.
You're standing in my position, sir.
I fucking knew it, you fucking twerp! Everything's gotta be just so for the SWAT officers. We can't fucking improvise, because then the whole plan just goes to shit.
There are several other moments that work well in the videos that follow, like when his team flashbangs himself.
See, now, you're gonna open the door, throw the fucking flashbang in the room. Ah, you fool! Why did you throw it into the door? It bounced right back in your fucking face!
Noah reads the signage.
I do love that graffiti, though.
You are dumb.
And when the team gets him killed.
Stop! Oh! Oh, come on! One of you guys, stop it! Like, we're all stacked up like cordwood!
Not to mention the general lack of empathy when his own team get killed.
Yeah, Jackson's down, but take your time. Gee, what a shocker. Red team threw a flashbang in their own faces and now they're fucking dead. Good job, Reynolds. Yeah, me and blue team ought to be able to handle this. After all, how many Chinese people could there be?
Since each video is separated into individual missions, it doesn't really qualify as being a multi-part video since each mission is started and completed. So I picked the one in the series where things start to kick off. But if you like it, then please watch the rest of the series as well. The last two are a little weak, number 14 and number 15, but the rest are worth the time it takes to track them down.
Okay, hiding from terrorists in the shower I get, but why would you turn the water on?
Number 20, DOA, Dead or Alive. Yeah, it looks like I spent a little more time on this pick. I made this one back in 2012, so nothing fancy like blending or adding lighting effects, but it looks better than the others so far. Around August of 2011, Spoonie started doing a number of videos based on fighting games turned into movies. He covered the animated Tekken, the motion picture, the live-action King of Fighters movie, the CGI film Tekken, Blood Vengeance, and he even did a crossover with Film Brain from Bad Movie Beatdown to review the live-action version of Tekken from 2010. All of them are perfectly fine reviews, but they really don't have any standout moments beyond the rather meaningless story and setup. But there was one review on a fighting game that was good enough to be on this list, DOA, Dead or Alive. Spoonie basically acknowledges that there is no plot to DOA.
The game has no plot! Seriously, like, zero plot! Okay, you know what? There is a story. I lied. There is a story.
We have the basic plot of a tournament featuring the best fighters from around the world where the winner wins $10 million.
Welcome to you,
villain. I'm sorry, has there ever been a guy in a movie running a martial arts tournament that wasn't trying to take over the world? And he's played by Eric Roberts. Just look at this guy. He's evil.
The main plot is absurd, the secondary characters are wasted, and the number of skimpy outfits is gratuitous.
Oh, Jesus.
But the branding is not really off-model. And you know what? Spoonie actually likes it.
Don't look at me like that! The games are about hot chicks in bikinis! And guess what? This is hot chicks in bikinis! Helena's ass is unbelievable!
The fight sequences are decent, the girls are ridiculously hot. And even though you might not know who Eric Roberts is, he has been working steady for a long time with just under 650 credits to him as an actor as of this video release. He is a decent actor that seems to be having fun with the role. The movie is silly, but it's shot well thanks to director Corey Yoon, who also directed the original Transporter movie, along with several older Jet Li movies like Hero, The Defender, The Legend of Fong Sai-yuk number 1 and 2, and the seminal film known in the West as Dragons Forever, with Jackie Chan, Sammo Hung, and Yuen Biao. This one is worth a watch on its own, not to mention Spoonie's review, so check them both out.
I mean, I watched King of Fighters, so you know, fuck it. I'm enjoying my smut.
Number 19, Beastmaster 2, Through the Portal of Time. Spoonie did a review on one of his favorite movies he remembered when he was younger, The Beastmaster. He admits it was still a decent adventure back when he was a little kid, but in classic form, Spoonie was really setting up his audience for the far inferior sequel, Beastmaster 2, Through the Portal of Time. Spoonie admits that even though he was excited to see a copy of the sequel in his local video store, he couldn't help but be disappointed by the cover alone.
Oh, hey, wow, look, guys, they're making Beastmaster 2. That movie was... Oh, fuck. Oh, for Christ's sake, what are they doing? Wait, wasn't the tiger black before? And where's the redhead with the killer Oh, fuck, this is gonna blow worse than Conan the Destroyer. Yep, they put the Beastmaster in modern Earth. I mean, hey, it really helps save money when all the actors can just wear street clothes and you don't have to buy costumes or spend money on set design and... You can just shoot most of the movie in a car and point the camera out the window or shoot a bunch of scenes at a producer's house of the heroes just sitting around watching TV.
Before you know it, a portal to another dimension is open to modern-day Los Angeles. Just roll with it. Spoonie mentions the problem with the title of the movie.
Yeah, notice how she said it was a dimensional portal, as in a portal to a world on a parallel dimension, as opposed to, you know, a fucking portal of time! In fact, she mentions specifically several times in this movie that time travel is in no way involved. Now, you could argue we're just talking a minor semantic detail, but I would argue it's only the fucking title!
The portal is opened long enough to let an annoying young woman through in a car. Anyway, Lorana tells Arklon of a weapon of mass destruction that he can steal in the future called the Neutron Detonator. Spoonie has a lot of fun with this review, including the ridiculous nature that the script takes at certain points. This review also introduces the Gaydar, an invention by Dr. Insano.
Oh hell, it broke my Gaydar!
You invented a Gaydar?
Yes, it measures gayness with science.
Why would you ever need that?
Oh, don't you worry about why I need a Gaydar.
This leads to one of the funniest cameos from Benzai, another contributor on That Guy with the Glasses back in the day.
This character is the most blatant and offensive flaming gay French stereotype I've ever seen.
No, my name's Benzai, and you know that I'm always kissing guys. I got the boogaloo flu, doing the do. It's called AIDS, semantics, anyway. Checking at guys, checking them out, ring a ding dong dong and a thong.
Never, we're never showing that clip again, never. Ah.
Benzai has done several videos with Spoonie during their time on the site together, and this certainly is one of his classic appearances. All of this culminates into one of the biggest gripes that Spoonie has with Beastmaster 2, which is when they drive by a movie theater showing...
What the fuck?
Beastmaster 2.
Beastmaster 2? They're driving past a theater showing Beastmaster fucking 2? Ah! Ah!
This kind of breaking of the fourth wall, where you make a direct reference to the movie that you're actually in, is just never done in cinema. The only time I can think of something similarly being done in any kind of media is when playing Total Recall on NES. Yeah, you could actually go into a movie theater showing Total Recall. Yes, it was just a tongue-in-cheek way of showing the game credits, but I never considered it to be so stupid that it ruined the game. And yes, I know that the Halo Infinite single-player and multiplayer mode actually has an arcade machine called Halo Infinite in the game, but that's not the same. And then, while I'm editing this video, Matrix Resurrections decides to do this very same thing. Without giving anything away, they don't necessarily make a reference to them being a movie themselves, but they do show scenes from the previous movies in their movie, something you normally don't do. Toward the end, Arklon hides in a zoo. Spoonie also points out this blunder. When you're in a movie where the protagonist is called the Beastmaster, who has the power to talk to and control animals, you don't hide in a zoo. This makes as much sense as pissing on Aquaman's face and then hiding in SeaWorld. It's not gonna end well for you. This video is a great look at just how bad it is to introduce the idea of taking your main protagonist from a medieval setting and bringing them into a modern-day location. It's also fun watching Spoonie as this bad follow-up just eats away at him. Number 18. Game Over. I know, later on I would just use the video thumbnail from YouTube itself. It was convenient and it gave me room to put channel info and a release date on the bottom. I remember seeing this movie on my local video store shelf. It immediately catches your eye since it does the whole Matrix cover ripoff, and so I would pass by it for months, even a year, until I got to the point that I had rented literally everything else I wanted to watch. So I picked it up one day and I found it to be one of the worst movies based on a video game premise that I had ever seen. And then Spoonie did a review on it years later. Game Over is not just your average bad movie, its total lack of substance is well known because it pulls off one of the dirtiest tricks in the film industry, using someone else's footage. Power Rangers is well recognized for doing this, but they do it in an inventive way, by repackaging a Japanese show into something that worked better for a Western audience. But Game Over goes one step further. It uses a large amount of footage from a canceled FMV game called Maximum Surge, originally planned for 1996. Given Spoonie's work on his FMV Hell series, he is in familiar territory here. This movie uses 25 minutes of footage originally filmed for full motion video sequences in 5 different digital pictures games. Most of it comes from that unreleased Maximum Surge game, but you also have additional footage from Corpse Killer, Prize Fighter, Supreme Warrior, and Quarterback Attack with Mike Ditka. The story is about a game programmer, Steve Hunter in this case, that is forced to play these games in order to beat a supercomputer. The writing is bad, and it fails at composing dialogue that feels natural for any human being to actually say. Forget about subtlety or character development, there seems to be a basic misunderstanding of how two people communicate or even relate to each other.
I hate meddling women.
Pinkerton, get out there and kill that bitch.
Professor Roswell.
Son, if you have a wife or a girlfriend, well, go to them, make love for one last time.
None of us have long left.
I'm a virgin, sir.
Oh, excellent.
Spoonie points out why the story doesn't work logically.
Super awesome supercomputer, it can do anything pretty much because it has artificial intelligence, and you've seen this movie about 100 goddamn times and you could write the script in your sleep, and I really don't know why they're even bothering to try building tension right now.
And even on a fundamental level.
You know what's worse than playing a shitty Sega CD game? Watching someone else play a shitty Sega CD game.
The review itself has a number of fun moments. I always like this review, and Spoonie brings up valid points on why this movie doesn't work. This review shows Spoonie getting better at scripting his reviews, and not relying so heavily on costumes and special effects.
This guy wants to send the Net Police spam emails? Well, he's called down the thunder and now he's got it. You people get on Twitter and tell these spammers what's coming. You tell them I'm coming, and hell's coming with me, you hear? Hell's coming with me!
Number 17. FMV Hell, Johnny Mnemonic. Look at that custom pic. No blending or blurring, just screenshots cropped and thrown on top of each other. Good old 2010 freeware technology at its finest. This was the video that kicked off the entire FMV Hell series for Spoonie. Originally released in three 10-minute parts, Spoonie takes a look at Johnny Mnemonic, the interactive action movie on PC. And yes, that actually is the real title. A very difficult game to run at the time because of the Windows 3.1 version. And even when using period-specific hardware, it would still crash all the time for Spoonie when trying to run this game. This was clearly an early video in Spoonie's career, but he does a fantastic job of showing us some of the earliest PC games to use FMV that he remembered at the time, like Mega Race and Critical Path. The acting was atrocious back then, being some of the worst you would find since most game companies didn't even have a budget for hiring professional actors themselves, so they just had to get whoever they could. Hey, who are you? You're the nighttime janitor because you don't do a good enough job for the daytime shift? Hey, you want to be an actor in a game? That's just how it happens sometimes. Spoonie recalls that the real frustration with these games was that they would often force you to change discs so often that it was ridiculous.
Where you would have to switch discs going to different rooms in the same building. Under a Killing Moon was the worst for that. But you'd have to switch between four CDs two or three times just going down the street.
No! But then we get to the main event, Johnny Mnemonic on PC. It follows the movie plotline for the most part, and the acting is bad. But clearly the writing is to blame for a lot of this. Spoonie explains how the limited mechanics of an FMV game work.
There aren't any hints. You just have to pick a direction and go. If you're wrong, you get shot. If you're right, you run to the next screen and repeat the process over and over again until you've played it so many times, you've just memorized the proper sequence. It's like playing Dragon's Lair without the flashing hints. Do I take the door? Nope. The hall? The window? Ugh.
Spoonie does a great job in telling us how you need certain items at certain times, like an adventure game. It's a lot of trial and error, trying different combinations, and trying to figure out where to go. This was awesome to see because you really didn't get to see anybody else taking the time to record footage for an old FMV game like Johnny Mnemonic back in 2007. He must have recorded footage for about 10 different games for these three videos alone. Sure, nowadays GOG.com has several of these multi-disc FMV games available that have been re-engineered to run much better on modern PCs, but they still don't have an updated version of Johnny Mnemonic on the site, as of the release of this video. Today on YouTube you can find playthroughs of many older PC games, so it's not so hard to find footage of games like this. But this video was an excellent way to take a look at this relatively obscure FMV game that was hard to get running at the time. This was a great video, and still worth checking out today. Number 16. Howling 2. Sturba, Werewolf Bitch. If you did a poll for what series of reviews or content that Noah Antweiler was best known for, the top two results should be Final Fantasy and Ultima. The next slot might not be so obvious, consisting of votes for SWAT 4 and his FMV Hell series, but the real third place belongs to Spoonie's reviews based on a single actor and his body of work.
Just hold on!
Reb Brown. Spoonie ended up making 21 videos on movies and appearances done by Reb Brown, This number includes an audio commentary and the 2014 April Fool's Day video. It started with his review of Yor, the Hunter from the Future in 2008, and it ended with Spoonie declaring the final review in 2016. The movies that Reb Brown starred in gave Spoonie some great material for his reviews, and we will see him show up at least one more time before this list ends. In Howling 2, Sturba, Werewolf Bitch, we have another great performance by Reb Brown as he teams up with Christopher Lee to fight werewolves. That's right, Saruman himself fighting werewolves. Reb's sister just happens to be the hero from the first Howling movie, but she's suspected to be a werewolf even after her death.
Your sister is a werewolf.
He said your sister is a werewolf.
Ah, bullshit.
Christopher Lee is about to finish her off, but Reb doesn't believe him. And when I say a great performance by Reb Brown, I mean in the classical sense.
Oh my god! So much for caring about his sister.
It's an amazingly bad movie that has absolutely no budget when it comes to the werewolf transformations, and a script done so poorly that most assume it started out as a vampire movie, then was changed to werewolves, but they somehow forgot to alter most of the previous vampire references.
Drive a stake through a werewolf's heart.
Isn't that vampires? Driving a stake into... That's vampires, isn't it?
To Transylvania.
Ah yes, Transylvania, well known for its werewolves. How do you fuck that up? So they unpack and... Is that a chain of garlic?
Just in case.
That's vampires!
Christopher Lee does his best to bring a classical tinge to his acting in this garbage movie, especially when he talks about magic holy earplugs.
To protect our ears.
Magic holy earplugs?
The highlight is when he uses his own holy hand grenade. Seriously, you gotta check this movie out on its own. You may laugh at those magic holy earplugs from earlier, but at one point the dwarf gets his earplugs knocked out at a crucial time, which causes his eyes to pop out. Howling 2 is such a gloriously bad movie that JonTron even did a review of it, but I still like Spoonie's review of it better. JonTron doesn't show Christopher Lee's outfit at the nightclub while going undercover, he doesn't cover the ending of the first Howling movie like Spoonie does, and he doesn't even mention Reb Brown by name, nor does he linger on his marvelous performance at all.
You know, Reb Brown has the acting range of an air horn.
Spoonie does the material more justice, and it's a bit more entertaining. It's probably the most mainstream movie that happens to star Reb Brown. Number 15. The Final Fantasy VIII Review. Final Fantasy VIII was a review that spanned 11 parts total, released across 28 months, from April 4th, 2007 to August 17th of 2009. There's a good chance that even if you only heard of Spoonie briefly in the last decade, you probably knew two things about him. You knew about his love for the Ultima series and his hate for nearly every Final Fantasy made after Final Fantasy VII. Spoonie's hate for Final Fantasy VIII was legendary back in the day. This was also his longest running combined review across multiple parts ever. That's right, the total length of all parts for Final Fantasy VIII is 2 hours and 43 minutes. Compare that to the second longest review ever of Final Fantasy XIII, which is 2 hours and 36 minutes. The first 7 parts were released across 6 months back in 2007, back when the video limit was 10 minutes on YouTube. Then a full year and a half went by while Spoonie moved on to other projects. But then, in February 2009, he comes back to Final Fantasy VIII with 4 more videos released over the next 5 months.
Final Fantasy VIII sucks and you suck for liking it!
Today, it's not entirely uncommon to find hour-long reviews for a single game, but back in 2007, you just didn't have many that were taking the time to rip apart a big AAA game throughout so many parts. Spoonie took his time to focus on the individual systems in Final Fantasy VIII and explain why each one didn't work. He showed drawing magic for 9 minutes just so that you could get a sense of how long you would end up doing it yourself. He talked about Triple Triad for 9 minutes, the most annoying of all the minigames he found. He also tackled the story in depth.
Man, what time? Time for you to get a watch. She is waiting for you to make your move. Don't say that. Singing a train song that she made up impromptu on the train, singing about how much she loves trains going to the future. Oh, Jesus. I'm actually going to hang out with Zell, seeing as how he is actually less crazy. I can't believe I actually said that. Zell, my god, man, you are in your 20s. Stop bouncing on the couch!
The first half of this review has unfortunately not aged well, since these parts were done in 2007. The video and audio quality is very low, and there are a number of gay jokes that come off as being a bit overdone, to put it nicely. Spoonie would later apologize for them in future videos, but just know they are still here. Things really kick off as he released the second batch of videos. Now he's using a proper DV camera, the sound is better, the effects are better, and Spoonie has taken the time to do more scripting this time around. He even does a short recap of those first 7 videos. So on repeat viewings, you may want to skip that first hour and 10 minutes and just start with part 8. We get a number of funny observations.
I can't believe how there's not a single screen of this game that I can't bitch about.
I hate this fucking game!
One of my favorite sketches was the boy or girl game show.
Final Fantasy VIII has been actually pretty good about keeping the androgynous anime-style characters to a bare minimum. I'd be on the fence about Irvin if he didn't clearly have a man's name, but as for Kyros, well, like, frankly, I have no idea. And yet I haven't seen a single solitary nude picture online of a female Kyros with Rinoa Quistis or Selphie. See, I want to go with my gut, but I need to trust the lack of porn. I'm sorry, I just need clearer evidence of breasts, so I'm gonna say... boy? Yes! Yes!
And I never forgot about the most succulent blowjob ever.
An overjoyed Zell rewards him with the most graphic, prolonged, succulent blowjob ever witnessed in a video game. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yes!
And then there was the big battle in his room at the end, which would become a staple of these Final Fantasy reviews moving forward. But despite my love for the original that started it all, Spoonie has actually outdone this particular entry when it comes to hating on Final Fantasy games. So expect us to return to the world of Final Fantasy later in the list.
Oh!
Number 14. The Black Hole of Board Games. WWF VCR WrestleMania Board Game. One of Spoonie's newer series was The Black Hole of Board Games, where he looks at board games that featured and included VHS tape. WWF VCR WrestleMania consisted of 2 hours of wrestling footage followed by a certain point total given to the red or blue side. And that's it. There's no strategy to the game since you can't control the cards you get or how many points you get from the wrestling matches on the tape. He mentions how this board game was just a cash grab. There's little to no effort put into making it. And just when you thought that this was the end of the video, Spoonie then goes that extra mile, dressing up as the Ultimate Warrior with makeup and shows off an actual real-life product, a bath time toy shaped like the Ultimate Warrior's head.
Pump the Ultimate Warrior's head until he sprays all over your children. Ooh, the WWF Squirthead is the new rubber ducky!
He not only has the real toy itself, but then he gets into the bathtub to complete the scene. It's funny as hell. Spoonie proceeds to dress up as another character from back in the day, the Iron Sheik.
Fucking spoon they want!
And he pokes some fun at himself in the process.
Final Fantasy VIII, my favorite game! How you say these things about the Final Fantasy? You used to be fun, Spoonie one!
By this point, the review has been good, but nothing special. But then, Spoonie brings back the costumes for one more go-around of nonsense. This isn't bad, but then he caps off the moment with some advice to each wrestling personality.
I used to respect a gamer!
Look at your boyfriend! No,
all right, shut up! You, for God's sake, man, stay away from the children's bath time toys and focus on the fucking video games!
What's a video game?!
You, stop making sex tapes! In fact, stop making sex altogether! And you! You never change.
Iran number one! USA!
And if that wasn't enough, he mentions that the VHS tape somehow included a clip of the wonderful Randy Savage. And Spoonie honors the memory of the wrestler's recent passing with one more costume change.
Jesus!
Just when you think you knew all the answers, I'll go and make you forget what the question is, yeah!
Which turns into a preview of his next Counter Monkey episode. It was a memorable review. Several costume changes, rules that were random, low production values for the VHS, all for a product that seemed rather pointless to even exist, which was perfect for the basis of a Spoonie video. He really put a lot of effort into this one.
I put you in the camera clutch, I break your back, and make you hang and fuck your ass!
Okay.
Number 13. Nostalgia Critic. Blood Rain. Back in 2009, Doug Walker gave Linkara and Spoonie plane tickets to Chicago, along with several other website members. It was for the first anniversary video of That Guy with the Glasses, which was going to be the epic brawl. Doug wanted to review a movie with Noah Antwiler and Lewis Lovehog, and he knew he wanted it to be one of the most popular movies directed by Uwe Boll. Doug unfortunately had lost his voice by the time it came to film the review. Nostalgia Critic, Alone in the Dark, is a decent look at the movie. There are some funny lines, a few humorous observations, and considering Doug had lost his voice, the review works rather well. Spoonie mentions that he and Linkara were guests. Doug wrote the entire script, directed the video, and while Spoonie and Linkara had some input into the details, the video was still mostly Doug's. Years later, the three schmuckheads would return in another Uwe Boll movie, and this one works much better. The Nostalgia Critic episode of Blood Rain seems like a much better collaboration of Doug Walker, Noah Antwiler, and Lewis Lovehog. They each have more to say, including a few rants that feel much more like the personalities that we've seen on camera before. There's a good balance between all three, and there's a nice cameo from the Cinema Snob. Just know that this video starts off a little slow. It's really not until the halfway point that the jokes start improving, the observations and setups get better, and we get a few cutaway gags that work well.
Is that Meatloaf?
Yep.
Wearing a 19th century powdered wig?
Yep.
Surrounded by whores and giving a performance more over the top than a kabuki pole vaulter?
Yep.
You like to watch the porn stars?
That is a lie! It is so obviously scripted. Who could be as stupid as Chum Lee? You are a fraud. A fraud!
Okay, so we have had plenty of time to put together our meatloaf jar. So let's shake this up and see what we can get!
Ladies and gentlemen, Wolfgang Amadeus Meatloaf!
How is it he managed to find a role even more demeaning than bitch tits?
Suddenly, his role in Spice World is looking like a step up!
This movie sucks!
Could use a lot more imagination on that one. Hey, okay, come on.
We were reaching the end of the break, I panicked!
And finally, I would do anything for Boll, but I will not act!
Fans have enjoyed this review so well that the comment section for this review and the making of videos have several wishing that one day the three schmuckheads would return in another Uwe Boll movie review. But most understand that given the events that have occurred over the last few years, that will probably never happen, but still, some hold out. There are only two crossover or collaboration videos that I thought were good enough to put on this top 25 list, so that means we only have one left. It's not that the others aren't worth watching, far from it. When Spoonie is the guest, this means he isn't the one writing the script or directing the video. He may alter some lines or make a few changes, but for the most part, his input is minimal. Sometimes Spoonie works with someone he really respects, which results in a great balance between the personalities that we end up seeing on screen.
You guys are so dramatic.
This is one of the best collaborations where Spoonie probably didn't write or direct most of the video himself, but you can still see his direct input during certain scenes.
Animatium Rage!
That did make me feel better, actually.
Number 12. Let's play Phantasmagoria, A Puzzle of Flesh. Spoonie found Phantasmagoria, a puzzle of flesh, at a used bookstore and decided to buy it. He really liked the first Phantasmagoria and enjoyed it back when it came out, but admits it didn't age well. He knew nothing about this sequel and wasn't even sure it would make a good Let's Play. He wasn't impressed after that first puzzle, where the hero not only couldn't reach his wallet under a relatively small couch—
Move the fucking couch! I can't move that!
But then realized the only option that he had left was to send in the pet rat after the wallet. Then when that didn't work, he used a granola bar to retrieve the rat, and it brings back the wallet. Despite some regret, Noah stuck with it, and even though he could only release videos in 10-minute chunks due to the YouTube limits at the time, this turned out to be a blessing since several viewers would comment on things to click on, give him hints on how to use certain items, and even mention some of the ways to unlock funny dialogue choices and a few hidden secrets. The Let's Play for Phantasmagoria 2 was originally released as 22 separate 10-minute videos. Look, I have proof. I still have those files I downloaded back in 2008. Man, that was a while ago.
Whoa, check it out. Green cubicles and purple walls. If that doesn't spell murder and horror, I don't know what does. Oh, god damn, that's good water.
Today, the Let's Play is easily findable in 5 separate 1-hour videos, and sometimes that last hour is divided into 3 parts.
Do you ever sneak into your boss's office and start just pawing through his photos?
You've got to stop it or I will!
Ah yes, the Christmas party.
I have a photographic memory of all the times I've been beaten up.
Overall, Spoonie is in top form. He is constantly coming up with more references and funny situations, and he keeps his energy up throughout the whole playthrough. There are a number of great moments, and a few times I found myself laughing out loud when Spoonie says something that catches me off guard.
Yeah, right. Like I want to talk to the king of the assholes.
Carlos Mencia?
Boom!
Don't take this personally, okay?
But you look like the angry video game nerd.
Have you thought?
Why don't you call me when you're done being an asshole?
Well, that could take some time, baby.
Crap, I changed my password. Oh, damn, what was it?
Phantasmagoria! Trying to remember your login!
I'll be there at 7.
AM or PM?
Don't disappoint me.
Hey, that's what I do, baby. I mean, not disappointing you. You know what I mean.
Oh, no. I wet him again.
Freak.
You know what, Bob? That's it! Me and you, outside!
But one of the most impressive moments comes at the end of the Let's Play. He beats the game, only to find himself actually in the game. That's right, he takes the time to do a spoof of the very game he just got done playing. He emulates the look of the game so it looks like he's a character, repeats some of the iconic moments from the game,
McFly!
And then makes an end credits montage to Shake, Rattle, and Roll.
Phantasmagoria!
Just like what you would find in a 1980s comedy film, though specifically it's a reference to the movie Clue from 1985. Nobody else put this much effort into their videos back then, much less a Let's Play. It was pure fun to watch, and it's one of the reasons why Noah is so well loved. Spoonie is at least trying a Joker reference just about every 1 or 2 minutes on average. Some work, some don't work, but seeing that this is a 5-hour Let's Play, the amount of stuff that ends up being funny is very impressive.
But in 2008, unbeknownst to me, a guy named Noah Antweiler of the Spoonie Experiment did one of the funniest, most celebrated Let's Play videos ever recorded.
The real Curtis, also known as actor Paul Morgan Stettler, even received some emails back when Spoonie first was releasing his videos. He actually started doing his own Let's Play of Phantasmagoria 2 in 2021 on his channel, Conversations with Curtis, along with interviews from the cast and crew. Check it out sometime, and it's not too bad. It's got a lot of behind-the-scenes stuff.
So if any of you out there is or was a huge fan of full motion video games from the 1990s and wonder why they don't make them anymore, I just want to say sorry about that. My bad.
Number 11, Black Hole of Board Games, Nightmare, Back in the Hole.
A long time no see, hey? Did you miss me? Shut up!
This is another entry where Spoonie takes a look at board games that had an included VHS tape. These types of games rose in popularity throughout the 1990s, With this came a whole host of companies trying to make VCR tape products. One of the most successful of these VCR board games was Nightmare, renamed to Atmosphere in Europe. The game sold more than 2 million units worldwide by Christmas 1993, only being on the market for 2 years at that point, and was successful enough that a DVD version of the game was made much later. Spoonie did a review of the first version of Nightmare back in 2009, and it wasn't too bad. In 2014, Spoonie launched his Black Hole of Board Game series, starting with the three added expansions for the original Nightmare game. Spoonie starts off telling us about the original game. He mentions the board layout is stupid, the odds of you getting the cards that you need is something like 1 in 36, and it's rather boring overall. But he reminds us of why that isn't necessarily a bad thing.
In this case, it's about context. It doesn't matter because it's a party game, and at parties, people are distracted by 100 different things, and in many cases, are rapidly getting drunk. So you're lucky if they're even paying attention, much less are interested in, you know, finely nuanced rules and balance. Now, the main draw here is the videotape.
The video is a combination of funny things said by the three different hosts, intercut with Spoonie reacting to or answering them.
Hit the hole!
Hit the hole? You're the gatekeeper! You're the gatekeeper! You're just wearing a silly hat!
Call me Baron Samedi!
Oh yeah, because you're just rocking that authentic Creole accent.
Turn around, turn out, turn tail, and grow long one rat!
Oh, I like you and hate you so much more than the last guy.
There are a few funny moments from the VHS tape footage sprinkled throughout, and some humorous reactions and lines from Spoonie.
Old game Nightmare.
Okay, dude, I've only had that expression once in my life, and that was when I saw Reb Brown doing this. I've played this game, man. There is nothing on any time card that could possibly elicit this reaction.
But this video is really at its best at being a brief look into the three expansions to one of the most popular VCR board games out there.
Please tell me you're not the gatekeeper in drag, because you are all kinds of spooky hot.
Indulge me. Love works in mysterious ways. I'm feeling playful.
And then, in the last 5 minutes, he throws another game at you. It's the second version of the first board game, now called Atmosphere: The Harbingers. This board is now modular and can be assembled in pieces. Now the paths branch off as you can go in any direction that you want and get the keystones that you need. There is some actual strategy in playing this version, so you might want to seek out a copy if you're interested. This one is actually designed by the same two guys that created the original Nightmare board game. His original video was funny and it had a few good bits, but this one crams all three expansions into one place, including a great summary of Atmosphere, the newly updated second version to the original. And this video remains to be more entertaining than the original. Number 10. FMV Hell, Demolition Man. It seems odd to have one of Spoonie's earliest videos so high on this list. He's still at his parents' house, so the sound is rather bad. The effects are basic, if not surprisingly subpar or missing. But regardless of the technical limitations, this still remains to be one of the best reviews Spoonie did based on the way he explains the gameplay mechanics. There are some funny moments, don't get me wrong, but the genius in this review is how Spoonie puts us in his shoes by asking some basic questions that the audience should be asking themselves. The personification of this lies in the game show-like quality of the segment, "What the fuck am I supposed to shoot?" It's a basic question that any gamer would ask when the enemy isn't taking any damage. This is possibly one of my favorite design segments in a Spoonie video. He asks a basic question and then gives you multiple guesses to choose what you think the game wants you to shoot.
Simon takes over an armored vehicle rocket launcher and starts shooting at you. I want you to point your finger at the screen where I should start shooting. Hell, I'm even going to give you two chances. Point two fingers at the screen, and if either one of them is right, you win the round. If you're pointing at the exposed head of Simon, wrong! I know, that was my first guess too, and it was wrong the first two times I tried it. I guess I never learned.
And he even gives you free guesses sometimes, and you still end up being wrong. It's a fun gimmick that involves the audience and asks them to point at the screen.
Well, now you're asking yourself, what the hell else is there? Okay, do you give up? Here, I'll show it to you one more time. The game actually does give you a clue. Here we go. Did you see that? Okay, one more time. Right there. The bomb and the plane moved downward when Simon took the controls. Why? I don't know. But that can't be what you shoot at, right? Well, guess what? It is what you shoot at. And when you hit it, it explodes. And for some reason, that scares him off.
Spoonie also does his trademark, let's see what the instruction manual says, where we get to see the actual description in the game's instructions, a thing that many of us had to do back in the 8-bit and 16-bit days, because most games never had a tutorial. They just threw you into the gameplay.
You suck.
Sylvester Stallone just said I suck. That's surreal.
Spoonie really shows how frustrating this game was to play back then. I had a 3DO and I always wanted to do my own review of Demolition Man, but after seeing how well Spoonie covered the game with the game show-like questions and how he explained how confusing some levels were, I just didn't think I could do much better.
So much for the three seashells.
Number 9. Spoonie and Linkara, Atop the Fourth Wall, Warrior Number 1.
Hello and welcome to Atop the Fourth Wall. Where bad comics burn.
The Warrior Number 1 review was filmed during the first That Guy with the Glasses anniversary movie, The Big Brawl, and it became insanely popular. Even though the video was called Atop the Fourth Wall, Warrior Number 1, Lewis Lovehog, also known as Linkara, has stated that Spoonie wrote the entire script on his own and directed the video. Him and Spoonie still improvise some of the lines and the hypertime setups on the day, but he gives Noah big props for coming up with all of his narration and showcasing his innate wrestling knowledge that Linkara would have never been able to do back then. The Warrior is a short 4-issue series of comics based on the real-life wrestler known as the Ultimate Warrior, well known for his insane and incoherent ramblings during many of his promotional videos. Someone decided to let the real WWE wrestler presumably conceive and write the entire series on his own. It depicts the adventures of the Warrior himself and his quest to master the philosophy of destrucity.
Or to make it even clearer, the truce between destiny and reality. Destrucity. Ugh. Oh, this makes my brain and my balls hurt.
It's never clear what exactly the overall story is supposed to be about, due to the utter nonsense that spills out of the narrator.
Where a being's only weapons are the cold, hard steel of his self-belief, and in the essence of himself, the animal in us all.
I have never in my fucking life read a comic that said so much and yet said so little.
The writer just makes up his own phrases, doesn't understand how to use punctuation.
I come only as a vision, wise in and of knowledge, not a fucking sentence.
And often doesn't follow basic sentence structure.
My attention, ellipses. It has ellipses, ellipses. Purposeful in its placement.
Stop using ellipses!
Spoonie is on fire in this video with his quick wit and sarcasm as he tries to dissect certain parts of the comic. Linkara and Spoonie showed up in 3 separate videos featuring comics based on the Ultimate Warrior: Warrior Number 1, Warrior Number 2 and 3, and then Warrior Number 4. Spoonie wrote and directed the first and the third videos. Linkara wrote and directed the second one. They're all worth watching, but the first one is still the best. Number 8. Wing Commander, the movie.
Well, let's get on with it. The movie that took my favorite video game series of all time out behind a woodshed and beat it to death with a shovel, Wing Commander.
Spoonie has had a long history with the Wing Commander games. It was his favorite video game series of all time. He was thrilled when they announced that a live-action film of Wing Commander was being made. The plot of Wing Commander 3 or 4 could have easily been adapted into a major motion picture, and the same creator of the games was going to be the film director, so everything looked like it was in good hands. But then Spoonie knew he was in trouble when he saw who was going to be the stars of the new movie.
Ah!
Spoonie mentioned some of the biggest actors seen in Wing Commander 3 and Wing Commander 4.
Like Malcolm McDowell, John Rhys-Davies, fucking Biff from Back to the Future, and he got to play as Mark fucking Hamill. That's like every kid's dream! It was one of the greatest ensemble casts in science fiction history, with two great games with plots easily adaptable to the big screen.
He compares those actors to the new ones.
I don't think I've ever seen a poster inspire less confidence in a movie than the three-headed monster of Freddie Prinze Jr., Saffron Burroughs, and the crown-fucking-jewel, Matthew Lillard, the skin-peelingly annoying jackhole from Hackers. And instead of casting Mark Hamill, you replace everyone with the main actors from She's All That? How do you fuck that up?
Spoonie continues to get more and more frustrated as the movie goes on, pointing out spelling mistakes at first.
They actually misspelled Admiral Tallwin's name Towlin, and while I'm at it, they misspelled Colonel Devereaux's name too. I just don't get it! The director of this thing was Chris Roberts, the guy who created the Wing Commander series. He wrote this whole thing! How do you get the names of your own characters wrong?
And showing the return of Turl, a portrayal of the character John Travolta played in the horrible sci-fi disaster known as Battlefield Earth. He pops up a few times, but doesn't overstay his welcome. Then we finally get to see the Kilrathi for the first time, close up. Just look at them! They look like hairless cats trying to cosplay as Klingons from the original Star Trek series. It just looks ridiculous. But the most ludicrous moment happens at the very end.
Look at the size of this thing! How do you accidentally fall into that? How does anyone mistake a black fucking hole for a fleet of battleships?
The Wing Commander movie review doesn't have a lot of big laughs like some of his better work, but it does cover the movie well. It shows that the pedigree from the game series did not follow into the film version, and Spoonie is at his angriest when he is talking about a movie or game franchise that he has had a long history with. He loved the Wing Commander series, and his anger levels are pretty high in this one, but there are two more franchises that he loves even more, and they are scored even higher on this list.
If Super Mario Bros. Was the first nail in the coffin of movies based on video games, then Wing Commander was the last.
Number 7. Let's Riff on Ripper. This Let's Play on Ripper was originally released in 11 parts over the course of 7 months, from June 2009 through January of 2010. There were only a few proper Let's Plays that Spoonie ever did, although don't confuse these with his live streams. The first was Phantasmagoria 2, then he did SWAT 4. The next was the star-studded FMV game known as Ripper. But he didn't call this a Let's Play this time. Instead, it was called a Let's Riff. And though Spoonie has never addressed it directly in a video, I do believe he has hinted at that he pre-recorded the sections of this walkthrough, edited it together, and then simply riffed on the video. And this makes sense. The Let's Riff on Ripper video series hits you with joke after joke.
Is there any difference between this murder and the previous ones?
It's identical. Absolutely identical.
Except for the different parts. Cut.
The only way to help Catherine is to restore the memories and personality the Ripper destroyed.
Yes, I see. Is your hair like a mange-infested clown wig on purpose? Wow, you go over the railing in this police station, you got a 200-foot drop. The future!
Often several references in a row.
There are thousands of ways to make money in the net, believe me, I know.
For instance, I'm a male prostitute on Craigslist. Hey, that reminds me, are you Trevor? I'm supposed to meet him here.
Wow, business is booming.
I heard that, Quinlan. Tag, you're in.
Looking for something, Quinlan?
It makes for a tightly coordinated playthrough that is entertaining, helpful, and it edits out all the tedium in the long-winded transitions and getting stuck on where to go next. And I wasn't joking about that star-studded cast. This is probably the most impressive cast list outside of Wing Commander 4. Spoonie also admits that some of the puzzles in the game are downright hard, but he doesn't waste your time as he tries to figure it out in real time. He gives you a few seconds to pause the video and try it on your own. Then he walks you through his process of figuring it out, and sometimes he admits that there are a few times you will likely know what the answer is, but the game programming itself can be a bit unforgiving on entering that information.
And once you know what the general pattern of the Pisces diagram looks like, you have to write that down, and then replicate that using the crystals in the little box. The only problem with that is you have to be so exactly precise when you lay your crystals down in this box. You look at the sheer number of little boxes here and the number of crystals that are given to you. You have to be exact or it doesn't work.
There are even at least a couple of times where the actors mumble their lines, so it can be kind of hard to understand a crucial clue that you need for a puzzle. This Let's Riff is a fantastic way to present the game, and it really gives you a sense of how puzzles were designed back then. Phantasmagoria 2 may have a few more classic moments when looking back at it, but Ripper is much better written and it removes a lot of the downtime. The pacing is stronger and the humor is downright genius at times.
Yes, because in the future you won't just enter in a text web address, you'll be forced to wander around the hellish virtual landscape of Mordor.
I don't understand this. How can you rebuild Catherine's memory?
Well, the way we always do in a case like this.
We put little elves in her ear.
Have my chances, though.
Yeah, remember Carla? I mean, I liked her, but she was just too needy. She was just after sex all the time. I mean, I'm not a machine, Quinlan.
Yes, several of the references are going to be from things that you probably haven't watched if you're only in your 20s, especially if you haven't seen many of the big movies from the 1980s, like The Warriors, Rocky, Indiana Jones, Back to the Future, and the Good Times TV series, to be specific. But that's more of a reflection of the projects that the actors in the game were a part of. Like, if you didn't know that this woman was in one of the Indiana Jones movies, then you're gonna be lost on several of the references. The Let's Play of Phantasmagoria 2 has a few stronger laughs and situations, and some probably prefer it when it comes to the content itself. You can't go wrong with Blob the Rat, nailing two different girls and then finding out Curtis fantasizes about hooking up with the gay guy at the office. But on a technical level, Ripper is better paced, has more laughs per minute.
Oh yeah, attack dogs, giant rats, minefields, monkey balls, you name it.
Monkey balls?
I can't tell you how to prepare for that world, brother. You's on your own.
I played Super Monkey Ball. That game sucks.
I said, can I help you? What'd you think I said?
Do me like a rotisserie chicken?
Nothing, I guess he thinks I'm an easy target.
But it wasn't me! It was the Warriors! They shot Cyrus!
My score was higher.
Come on! Go for the gold, Quinlan!
You're a funny guy, Sully. I like you. That's why I'm going to kill you last.
And Spoonie even helps you solve the puzzles. What more could you want? Number 6. Ultima, Ruins of Virtue, Part 1 and 2. After Spoonie finished his review of all the main Ultima games on PC, he followed it up with this two-part video. This is a look at the Ultima games that made their way to the Super Nintendo. He briefly covers Ultima 6 and Ultima 7, but he wasn't very happy with either one. Then we move on to the main review of an Ultima game specifically made for the Super Nintendo, Ultima Ruins of Virtue 2. Later in the video, he covers the original Ruins of Virtue on Game Boy. The main villain is just some random Black Knight, and we watch as he plans out his evil, plan. You hear the music to Lazarus's Goodbye Horses, but you think there's no way Spoonie would actually do it, but then he does the full Buffalo Bill dance. It comes from the movie Silence of the Lambs, and I can't really show what happens, but in the scene, the killer fantasizes that he's a woman, and then proceeds to tuck his penis and balls back behind his legs. You know, making it look like he has a vagina from the front. You may have seen it parodied by Jay in Clerks 2.
Oh.
Would you fuck me? I'd fuck me. I'd fuck me hard.
And again by Jay in the Silent Bob reboot. And by Chris Griffin, of all people, in Family Guy.
Do me so hard.
You got to admit that not many YouTubers would have the balls to actually show themselves replicating this particular scene in front of their fans. And yes, of course, he still censors it on YouTube. Spoonie shows us that the game itself is way scaled back from the PC games. The combat is poorly designed, you can't tell what you are taking damage from, and you can't tell if you are even doing damage to enemies half the time. Spoonie's anger is high, especially when he walks outside and decides to pick a fight with a seahorse.
Fuck that thing too! Get the fuck out of here, seahorse! Oh, holy shit, it brings lightning! I'm sorry! What the fuck was that? So laugh it up! But you know what?
humanity always wins in the end, because you know why? Next coral reef I see, I'ma pollute the fuck out of it. So choke on these nuts.
Even though he just finished the Ultima 9 review, he whips out a few costumes, some props, the green screen, and puts more effort into this review of the Super Nintendo games than you would normally think. The humor is also on point.
Kenny! Ah, great. Now I've got seahorses. It's just gonna sit there, isn't it? Shitting all over the floor. Well, I have to kill it. I mean, we both know where this is going, yeah, but do you want seahorses in your house? Oh! Whoa! Anticlimax for the win! Carpet's fucked. Don't care!
Spoonie has gotten much better at deciding what dialogue is funny enough to leave in his reviews. Nearly every scene has something funny in it.
What are these things? What are they? I can't kill them either! They're completely immune to damage! Did Dr. Insano make these? They're like huge, floaty, fleshy testicles!
And this game gives them a lot to work with. The enemies are bad. The weapons are bad. They don't know how moon gates work. There are cheap deaths everywhere. And there's no music to speak of throughout most of the game. This is probably the best written and performed video game review that Spoonie released after his Ultima 9 review. Some say he peaked at Ultima 9, and you might be right, but this one is still a lot of fun. Definitely don't miss this two-parter.
Okay, that's it. I quit!
Number 5. FMV Hell. Halloween Special. Blood Wings. Pumpkinhead's Revenge.
All in an attempt to answer one simple question. What the fuck is this?
This was probably the most obscure game that Spoonie ever ran into since he started making videos. He never came across another game like Pumpkinhead, where he couldn't find any info on at the time of his review. In the audio commentary, Spoonie mentions the overall failure of reviewing this game, not being able to get past the first stage, not being able to understand the mechanics, or figure out what the game wanted him to do next. In the video itself, he actually alludes to this frustration. He had planned sketches with Linkara, costumes, special effects, the whole works. But since he had such a hard time with the game and barely made any progress after a month of playing it, he threw a lot of it out. Spoonie even takes us through his opening thoughts as he boots up the game for the first time.
You know what? Already I got a big problem with this fucking game. Who the fuck is this? Where the fuck are we? Is this medieval times? Is she a witch? Someone's grandma? Is she Pumpkinhead? Who the fuck is Pumpkinhead? Where's the world of Pumpkinhead and why the fuck am I entering it?
Spoonie thought maybe the movies would give him a clue, so he bought and watched them both.
So the kids run off to the nearby gravesite and start to exhume the old lady's dead son so they can cast the spell because... kicks?
Let's do this!
Well, that didn't help. Then he bought another copy of the game so that he could get his hands on the actual instruction booklet. But even that didn't help him get much further in the game. He never thought that he would end up making so little progress in a first-person shooter based on the second Pumpkinhead movie. Spoonie gets more and more frustrated as the review goes on until he loses it at the end.
You have not returned the stolen goods. Your entire inventory has been confiscated.
What? What? You wiped out my inventory? What? That's bullshit! That is bullshit!
You have failed. You have failed.
Pumpkinhead!
And that's where the video ends. In the audio commentary, Spoonie does admit that he thought his utter failure at trying to understand the game actually made for a good video in itself. This video remains to be one of my favorites, not just because of the solid humor or numerous cutaway gags, but because of the journey that Spoonie shows us he had with spending so much time with this unknown FMV game he found in a bookstore for $3. Eventually a follow-up video would happen, Until We Win, Blood Wings, Pumpkinhead's Revenge Revisited, where Spoonie and Lord Cat would finally beat the game. This was back when Lord Cat was still doing his Until We Win series. I didn't include it in this top 25 list because, although it is interesting to finally see what was required to beat the game, the video itself is fairly straightforward and it doesn't really contain a lot of humor. So seek it out to conclude Spoonie's journey with the game, but this is the video that started it all. Oh, and there's a nice cameo of Benzai and Barry at the end. And no, I didn't forget about the third video based on this game, but that's just an alternate ending that they missed the second time around.
Are you sure?
No turning back now.
Yeah, right on, man! There's no turning back now! Wait, why? Actually, there's every opportunity to turn back now. We could just stop digging and go home. In fact, we could literally turn back now.
Number 4. Red Brown Retrospective, Robo War. In the audio commentary, Spoonie says that this was one of his favorite reviews that he's ever done up to that point. This is partly due to the source material itself. Spoonie says there's nothing better than a Red Brown movie to review, just because he goes all in with his acting. And the other part was the participation with Dark Maze Studios and the footage that Ed Glazer produced. Some fans were split on the style used here, intercutting scenes from the movie with scenes they filmed as a spoof. It really just mimics what you would have seen on a sketch comedy show like In Living Color or Mad TV back then, and I always loved these scenes being there. They really showed an extra bit of effort that nobody else was doing at the time. The Robo War movie itself is probably in the top 3 of the most entertaining Red Brown movies to watch, thanks to director Bruno Mattei. It's partially a ripoff of the movie Predator, but it also uses other movies for inspiration. This review has a few great bits.
Why do they have nicknames?
You should know what the group is called. BAM.
BAM?
Big-ass motherfuckers.
Big-ass motherfuckers.
Big-ass motherfuckers.
Big-ass. Like, they have big asses? Or, how the fuck does that answer his question?
And the music is pulse-pounding.
Oh, yeah.
And there's even a great callback to those that watched his playthrough of SWAT 4.
You're in my way, sir.
The footage from Dark Maze Studios is well done. Its nonsensical setups perfectly mimic those found in the movie itself.
Any questions?
Who are you?
I'm afraid that's classified. Technically, I don't exist. I'm not here. We're not having this briefing.
We didn't have a briefing.
Good man.
No, really. You just walked in here and said we are leaving at 0600.
No, I didn't.
But we don't even know where we're going.
I'm afraid that's strictly need to know.
But how are we supposed to get there if we don't know where we're going?
Reviewing Red Brown movies has become synonymous with the name Spoonie, almost throughout his entire career, ever since 2008. And Robo War is definitely his best Red Brown movie review. This review was a standout, especially at the time, because it was a movie that you just couldn't find yourself at a local video store. To find something like Robo War around 2010, you could only find it in a Japanese video store, which means you really needed to know someone that dealt with Hong Kong bootleg videos in order to find a copy. Around 2012 or so, we started seeing a resurgence of Blu-ray releases on several well-known exploitation films, and in general, just lower quality B-movies that had become known as cult classics or famous among collectors. And yes, that means in 2019, Robo War became available on DVD and Blu-ray, now scanned in 4K from the original negative and loaded with all new special features. It's rather impressive to see such a clean negative from a movie that spent 20 plus years being relatively unknown. Today, you don't really need to know a Hong Kong distributor. Amazon and Walmart will have copies on hand to sell for almost any movie you can think of. And I guess the world is just a little bit better for that.
Hey Spoonie, this is Reb. Listen, I miss you. I miss hearing your comments and hearing you and looking at you. God bless you. Hope everything is okay. Hang in there, buddy. You take care, okay? And remember, I still remember February.
Number 3, the Final Fantasy X review.
Okay then!
Final Fantasy X was a review that spanned 4 parts, released across 11 months, from March of 2010 to January of 2011. The brilliance of this review is in its simplicity, especially when compared to the 2-hour, 43-minute length of the Final Fantasy VIII review. I really thought that the Final Fantasy VIII review was going to be in the top 5. Hands down, no contest. It's iconic, and everybody knows that the name of Spoonie is synonymous with his hate for Final Fantasy VIII. But in rewatching all the Final Fantasy reviews, and then watching them a second time, and then watching them a third time, but this time back to back, it becomes clear that while the original Final Fantasy VIII review is very memorable, and it's what started it all, Spoonie got better at scripting and pacing as time went on. Spoonie's Final Fantasy X-2 review was also great, but he admits that there were only a few good parts to it. The Final Fantasy XIII review was massive in its scope and scale, and even though Spoonie was very detailed and thorough in analyzing the plot and its characters, his anger really didn't come across on screen like the other reviews. There weren't as many humorous moments or sketches like the others. But his Final Fantasy X review? It is, without a doubt, the best Final Fantasy review done by Spoonie. Give Spoonie a huge reason to hate the main character and sprinkle in some humorous references, and you got an anger-filled hate fest that is one of the best reviews done by Spoonie overall. Spoonie centers on the complete lack of redeeming qualities in our main protagonist, Titus.
Something instinctive that whenever I see this guy, I just want to punch this motherfucker!
And he hits that point pretty hard.
This sissy shorts wearing fucking bat face Leonardo DiCaprio looking jack off, fuck this guy!
And I mean hard.
Fuck him and his leather lederhosen! I hate his fucking Meg Ryan hair! I hate his smug fucking hideous Artal Jr. face!
And he doesn't let us forget it.
Listen to my story.
No! Fuck you! Fuck your story! It sucks! Someone help me! Send help!
He calls bullshit on Blitzball, and just how absurd of a game it really is, and he covers the infamous laughing scene. The Final Fantasy VIII review is still good, but Spoonie really does outshine that review in every category here. The final battle has Spoonie in at least four different costumes, with special effects, help from his brother on some of the reverse shots, and a nice callback to the lame game ending in his review of Bloodwing's Pumpkinhead's Revenge. I can easily recommend all of his Final Fantasy reviews. Final Fantasy VIII can be a little rough, especially that first 1 hour and 10 minutes of it, but it still has some great moments. Final Fantasy X-2 is rather good, and Final Fantasy XIII is very detailed, but just not as funny as the others. The Final Fantasy reviews would typically take Spoonie about a year to make, at a minimum. It takes time to go through a 40-plus hour RPG multiple times, write a script, and then sit down and try to find and edit all that footage together. But the end product has always been worth it when the name Spoonie is attached to it.
And every fucking time he opens his big fucking mouth, I just want to stab him in the throat with an ice pick just to watch him die! I hate him! I hate you! I hate this game!
Number 2. Highlander, The Source.
I'm just gonna throw this out there, and you're not gonna believe me. Because it's not possible. I still can't really believe it, but I'm gonna say it anyway. Highlander The Source is a worse fucking movie than Highlander 2 The Quickening, and that is not a statement one can make lightly.
In the audio commentary for the review, Spoonie says that he considers his Highlander The Source review to be one of his masterworks. He acknowledges that all of his Highlander reviews were building up to this project. Up to this point, this review was the single longest, angriest, and the most screaming Spoonie has ever done for one video. Spoonie has said in the audio commentary that he doesn't believe that he has ever been madder at a piece of media other than Highlander The Source.
Get ready to have Highlander ruined for you all over again, just like the first time, because it's time to go back to the source.
Spoonie is still convinced to this day that someone in charge must have wanted to destroy the Highlander franchise. Every decision in this movie not only goes against all known canon, but it does things that you just don't do in any kind of movie. Fans will find nothing familiar. They changed the setting.
This apocalypse looks like it was a bad one too. Look, you can't even go 10 yards without running into a flaming barrel.
They changed the personality of the characters.
He's also the only man I've ever loved.
And you are?
They changed the relationship to other characters that you once knew. The Highlander anime is halfway decent in the eyes of some fans and is probably considered the second best entry in the entire franchise because at least they stick to the rules that were set in the other works. In Highlander The Source, they break all the rules of the series. Our band of immortals at one point become all mortal. The lead antagonist has superpowers that have never been seen to this degree in any other film or the two TV series. Sure, there were some moments of magic or mysticism here and there in the series before, but typically the story would boil down to two guys fighting with swords in a very real-world form of combat. You didn't see people jumping 10 feet in the air or running across treetops like in Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. But this guy? He has super speed, he shows up suddenly like he can teleport, and he takes out most of his foes with a single move. There is basically no fight choreography. The action scenes are often overly stylized, flashy, and filled with special effects like blur and smearing, plus the camera is often whipping around so fast that you can't tell what's going on. There have been isolated Highlander moments in the past where the production crew clearly had no time to set up a proper fight scene. It happens sometimes during a movie shoot. But this movie? It looks like they didn't even want to try to do realistic sword fighting. Then one of the ultimate betrayals happens, and Spoonie nearly loses it. They actually do a cover to Princes of the Universe. They paid to use the real licensed song on every episode of the TV series, but for the first time they pay another band to do a cover of the single most famous piece of music in the entire franchise. There is a reason you never hear a cover band do a rendition of a Queen song in any form of media.
Not only were they content to destroy Highlander, but they had to kill Queen too? Freddie Mercury is spinning in his fucking grave right now! Highlander 2 never reached this level of abject fuckness!
But it doesn't end there. At the very end, Spoonie becomes possibly the angriest he has ever been seen on camera. It's the moment the prize is finally revealed to be after all this time. Not counting what the prize was in Highlander 2, of course.
But it wasn't about death. It was about life.
Fuck you and die!
Duncan was the one to have a child. A gift from the source to us and the world.
No! No! Not this way! You're telling me that this whole time, everything we've ever been told about fucking immortals, their fundamental reason for existing since the first fucking movie, the foundation for the entire series, fighting until only one remains, was always complete bullshit?
The review doesn't have any wacky costume changes, clones fighting each other, Burton flying around, shooting rockets, or really any special effects. It's just Spoonie, the camera, and his true feelings on one of his favorite movies growing up. It's simple, and it isn't very complex, but it still stands out as one of his best written pieces of work.
This movie did more damage to my childhood memories than The Phantom fucking Menace. It's not only the worst movie of the series, it's damn near one of the worst, most offensive, piss-poor movies ever made, and it can kiss my ass! Fuck you two!
Number one. The Ultima 9 review. There should be no doubt as to what should be number one. No other review received as much scripting, research, and time put together than Ultima 9. Spoonie realized early in the process for writing the review on Ultima 9 that the audience was never going to truly understand his pain unless he took them through every Ultima game leading up to it. The other Ultima reviews were decent and had a few funny lines or observations, but for the most part they were short and to the point. But the real magnum opus for Spoonie would be the review for Ultima 9. It wasn't his longest combined review, Final Fantasy VIII and Final Fantasy XIII were longer, but this review still sits at just over 2 hours. Spoonie attacks this game with a kind of focused tenacity that only he was known for. He systematically tears apart each section of the story and how it doesn't line up with the other games.
Why does the Avatar have an Ankh on his tabard in games that took place before Ultima 4? Because the Ankh is the symbol of the Avatar, and he wasn't the Avatar in Ultimas 1, 2, or 3.
Betrayed me!
This is supposed to take place on Pagan, right? During the execution scene at the beginning of the game, but the sky is the wrong color. The landscape is completely wrong. It's not hilly because the game takes place at the foot of a giant fucking volcano. The sun is shining when the sun not shining is one of the key defining characteristics of the world of Pagan. Most people on Pagan don't even fucking know what the sun is. It's why the guy summoned Pyros in the first place, just to ask him what the sun is like. I haven't even started this game, and everywhere I turn, I see something I could bitch about for hours.
Even though it's 2 hours long, Spoonie has done a great job at editing down and trimming away the fat. Since Spoonie brilliantly walked us through the previous 10 games in the series that he reviewed, the audience actually has a basis of knowledge on how things work in this universe. So when something is wrong, we can all sense it too, not just Spoonie.
It's wrong! Moon gates are not fucking purple and never have been.
Betrayal!
What evil has been unleashed in Britannia?
I'm not entirely sure.
What evil? The Guardian! You shitheel! You've been fighting the motherfucker for 4 goddamn games! How do you not know this?
Of the gargoyles.
I'm sorry, but what? I mean, who are the gargoyles?
What, the gargoyles? Ah, you wouldn't know them. You only stole their most sacred holy book, dropped the Earth's crest on their homeland, and spent the entirety of Ultima 6 dealing with them, you dumb fuck!
Betrayal!
The back and forth that Spoonie does with some of the characters is some of the best I've seen done with any reviewer in the last 10 years. It's so natural, and yet when they say something stupid, he is quick with a response.
What?
The Codex of Ultimate Wisdom?
What?
The Codex of Ultimate Wisdom?
Ah! The Avatar has to ask what the fucking Codex? No! No! No, it's a...
But then he escalates these conversations to another level when items are brought up that the player character should know by now.
I thought that I knew all of the paladins around here.
What's a paladin? What's a paladin?
What's a paladin?
What's a paladin?
Show it again.
What's a paladin?
Again.
What's a paladin?
It's the line itself. It's a middle finger right up the ass to anyone who ever gave a shit, who ever got emotionally invested in the story, or the characters. Why? Well, not only has the Avatar been around paladins since before he was the fucking Avatar, one of his closest friends and oldest, most stalwart companions through every adventure, Sir Dupre, he was a paladin who literally sacrificed his life by jumping into a cremation oven alive in the Avatar's place to save the entire world and the cosmos as we know it.
Spoonie's knowledge of the games is superb, and he calls out everything the game designers get wrong.
Where did you get your hands on that book?
Oh, that's not important, Avatar.
Yeah, it fucking is important, because I sent it beyond time and space to the ethereal fucking void. I spent all of Ultima 6 doing that so that no one person could claim possession of the fucking thing.
You really feel the pain as Spoonie tells you about all the repetitive aspects that have plagued this series from game to game. The combat is horrible. The enemy variety is poor. The only form of progression in these games is completing a number of switch puzzles. And the story often consists of doing repeated actions across multiple dungeons. That's it. Spoonie goes to a whole new level of anger when Dupre, one of your party members that sacrificed himself in a previous game, gets brought back to life, completely undermining his previous act of bravery. This event leads into the most visceral breakdowns shown on camera in any video featuring Spoonie.
You did it, Avatar! When you restored the final shrine, I was given my life back!
Upon the realization that Dupre is now alive, Spoonie pauses for several seconds, then he gets up and grabs a stack of Ultima games and books, and he sits back down and recounts his memories while playing the games with his brother as a kid. These games ended up teaching him how to read when he was younger, and his anger builds as we watch, all in one take, as we begin to understand what this game series meant to him. There are many great moments, and the humor works at nearly every turn. Ultima 9 is presented in 3 parts, and in each one, Spoonie is at his best, firing on all cylinders, and it culminates in one of the greatest moments across all of his Ultima reviews, if not across his entire body of work to date.
They were sometimes known as the 12 Peers.
What?
Now, historically, they were the foremost members of Charlemagne's court, although many of their most famous exploits are largely fictitious, representing Christian martial superiority over the Saracen hordes.
What are you drivelling about?
Well, my friend, that's a paladin.
And there you go, those were the top 25 videos from Spoonie. Go ahead and click like or even subscribe if you thought that I did a good job with this video. What videos were your favorites? What are some moments that you will never forget from his many appearances? Share them in the comments below, and please be civil, this is a video that honors the hard work that Spoonie put into his videos over the years. Please stick with me for a few more minutes. I just have a positive message for Spoonie and his fans, and then we will see the end credits with funny moments from Spoonie and other highlights from people he's worked with over the years. I know some of you have ill feelings toward Mr. Antweiler and his dealings over the years, but I made this video to celebrate his best work, not to acknowledge or condone his previous actions. Let's come here to share our thoughts about the time Spoonie made content to help us through our own misfortunes. Let's not kick him while he's down or blame him for not handling things in a different way than what he did. I want Spoonie to know that he still has fans that love and cherish his work from back in the day. Sure, I would love for him to make new videos, new reviews, new counter monkeys, new subjects brought to you from a charismatic personality with the expertise of 14 years of video production and the skill to pull it off. I wish the website was back so it was easier to find all this content in one place. But right now, it's been over a year since Spoonie has even released a video of any kind. He seems very depressed, and he has said himself on Twitter that he doesn't have any more stories to tell, and that he just doesn't have it in him anymore. Mr. Antweiler has been on an emotional downward slope throughout 2021, and I just want to take the time to wish him well here. If you have a positive message for Spoonie, then leave it below. We can't comment on his videos directly anymore, so this might be your only chance. Maybe there's a possibility that someone he knows will direct him here, and even if he doesn't watch the video itself, I would like for him to see your kind messages. Maybe he will find encouragement in them. Send your prayers toward him if you believe in that. I just want Mr. Antweiler to know that regardless of the things that happened in the past, some of us just want you to feel better. So take care of yourself, Spoonie, and we'll see you when we see you. In whatever form that may be.
Hello?
Yeah, it's 3:22 p.m.
What?
I thought you were asking what time it was.
No, no, I'm telling you it is time!
Yeah, and that time is 3:22 p.m.
No, no, I got another call, hold on. Hello?
All around the world, rock and roll is the only place.
McCoy has a contract, and you have to go back to the planet Vulcan, and then Sarek has to put it, what? Rock and roll is the only place.
All the flat top cats, the rock and roll queen.
Just why do I ask these questions? Why, French Conan?
All around the world, rock
keep
and roll
your
is the
thing
you wanted.
Nobody can see you winking under the goggles, numbnuts.
Yeah, you're that Mr. Spoon guy, right?
Yeah, that's right. I forgot my
line
already. I'm sorry.
All in the hit the flow, go cat go. All around the world, rock and roll is here to stay.
Oh, come on.
You can hear those jukebox jumping.
That is cheating of the highest magnitude.
Spoonie, name me one Motel 6 that has their own personal ass wiper in every bathroom. Once you've had Lars wipe your ass for you, you can't go back.
Speaking of children, why do you hate children so much?
I love children. I don't know why you think I have this thing for children.
You love dead children. You love dismembered children.
I do love dead and dismembered children also.
I will create the world's first human spider.
I gotta shit.
What? No. 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 Don't. Oh.
And a 200-watt, 110-volt to 220-volt step-up power transformer.
Okay, so why don't you just play it on an emulator?
You don't get it, do you?
Anyway, that's just about all the time we have with Spooning with Spoonie. Oh, ooh, easy, man, I'm not a nut.
Hi.
Would you like to know more? Did you enjoy the video you just watched? Well, go to my channel for more. I got my Rage Quit 2 series, my How the F Did I Die series, and a little more. Are you curious what I've been working on recently? Well, check the community tab on my channel. Yep, that's just right here. Click on that and you'll find the place where I give occasional updates on what I'm currently working on or on what videos are coming up next. Now that you've seen my list on the top 25 videos of Spoonie, are you trying to track down a particular video? I made a separate video called How to Find Noah Antweiler Videos Today, the Spoonie one. In this one, I will show you where you can find Spoonie's videos today, including several well-known websites and fan-made archives. Many videos don't show up on his YouTube site anymore, so I'm going to walk you through several places to find the videos that you might be looking for. I also made another video called The Top 5 Counter Monkey Episodes from Spoonie. I always wanted this to be part of the main video itself, but it was running too long, so I had to make some cuts. So take a look at my thoughts on the best 5. Both of these new videos should show up right now on the left side of the screen. On the right is more videos of mine, so please check out more of my content if you like what you've seen so far. Thanks for watching. It was a lot of work, but Spoonie's content has helped me through the tough times, so now I'm honoring him.